friends. My name is Sydnee, and we're here this Wednesday at our Pinelands Tree Farm to showcase some of our camellias. It's finally getting cool, and it's a perfect time to showcase these beautiful flowers that are loving this weather. So as you can see, I'm kind of standing in a part shade situation. In our area, our camellias love the shade to part sun. Now, behind me right here is a Camellia sesanqua. These actually can take a little bit more sun than some of our other varieties that we have. But in general, part sun to part shade is perfect. As far as water requirements go, to establish a camellia of this size from a container, you want to water on a regular basis at first to keep the soil moist and then back off from there. Once they're established, very easy to maintain. You just kind of have to supplemental water in the spring and summer when we get really warm. As far as care for the camellias, they're gonna bloom this time of year starting in October through December, January. And then in January, our japonicas will start blooming, and those will last until spring when it gets warm. Once spring rolls around, you can start to trim your camellias and shape them as necessary. And you can do that after the blooms are done. You can trim the tops, come through the bottom and clean them up a little bit, mulch them, and just kind of get them ready for the rest of the year. So now we're going to talk a little bit about the fertilizer requirements that camellias need to bloom as spectacular as this one I'm standing next to. So here at Pinelands Tree Farm, we use a slow-release 8-16-11 fertilizer. So that's a lot of information, and what that means is it is going to release nutrients over time, in this case over the course of 6 months. The benefit of that versus something like Miracle-Gro or a fast-acting fertilizer is you prevent burn to the roots. It's also a better bang for your buck because you're not having to constantly refertilize that plant. Now the numbers on 8-16-11, what that means is that 8% nitrogen, 16% phosphorus, and 11% of potassium is being used throughout that amount that you're fertilizing with. So for the nitrogen, that is going to promote healthy green leaves, overall general health of the plant. For the middle number, which is phosphorus, is what is going to promote all these beautiful blooms that you see. So a higher middle number means more blooms. The last number, which is potassium, is for your overall root health of the plant. So if you're wanting to get a plant to bloom more, you need a higher middle and third number. Camellias are a pretty carefree, easy to maintain plant. Occasionally you'll see some issues, and they're usually fungal issues with camellias, especially here in the panhandle of Florida. We get a lot of rain, a lot of moisture, which unfortunately means fungal issues. To help maintain that, a few things you're gonna notice if you get fungal issues. One to be on watch for is petal blight. And what petal blight will do is when the flowers start to open, they're either not gonna open quite right, they'll be somewhat deformed, but they'll look rotty. They'll be brown and mushy, and just they don't look good. The best way to get rid and treat for petal blight is to remove any of those fungal diseased flowers, take them off, cut out the dead branches, and toss them away, get rid of them and destroy them. You can also treat them with a fungicide, generally a copper-based fungicide, in the spring or early fall. Another issue on camellias that we have here in Florida is a canker or a leaf gall issue. And what that is a fungal disease is breeding itself into a hardened mass. And that'll usually show itself either on the underside of the leaves or for cankers on the stems. The best way to prevent and treat for that is kind of the same you do for the petal blight. You want to trim out any of the diseased or cankered branches, destroy them, get rid of them, and treat with a general fungicide. We recommend a copper-based fungicide. You can also use systemic fungicides that are specifically for camellias, if that's something you can find. So if you're interested in propagating camellias, it can be a little tricky, and I have some tips to share with you. Now, it is not the time of year particularly to take your cuttings. You want to wait until we warm back up in the spring when they start to shoot off their new growth that's going to be the softer growth. That's usually around March and April when we can do that. And what you'll want to do is you'll want to get some of the semi-hardwood that has started to come out of the new growth. And what that means is that it started to stiffen, but it's not quite all the way solid like some of your lower branches. It's still got some bend in it. You'll want to come in with clean pruners, come under a node, which is where the leaves are coming out, at an angled cutting. You're going to want to take these cuttings and dip them into a rooting hormone, into a perlite, or a very soft seed starting mix, something that's going to hold moisture but be very well draining. And you're going to want to keep that damp. You don't want to let it dry out while it's trying to root. It can take weeks for it to root, but eventually they will. And that is a way to get a proper cutting that will maintain the blooms of the parent plant that you chose. Here at Pinelands Tree Farm, we have a large variety of different cultivars of camellias, and I'm going to showcase a few of our most popular ones and how to use those in the landscape. So the first one I'm going to show you is the Leslie Ann Camellia Sasanqua. It is one of our larger growers. The Leslie Anns will get 6 to 10 feet at maturity, and they have a more upright, narrow habit. The next one we're going to talk about is our October Rose Camellia. It's very similar to the Leslie Anns. It's going to get 6 to 8 feet at maturity and about 3 to 4 foot wide. So again, a very narrow, upright grower. Another thing I meant to mention with the most of our Sasanquas, they can grow in a lot of sun. As you can see here, these get a lot of morning sun, and later in the day they'll be in the shade for the hot afternoon, which is what you want. So the last large grower we're going to talk about is one of my personal favorites. This is the Yuletide Camellia. It's got an actual true red color with a yellow throat. It is also, again, very similar to the October Rose and the Leslie Ann Camellias, growing 8 to 10 foot at maturity with a very narrow upright habit. So now that we've showcased some of our larger camellias, I want to shed some light on some of our dwarf varieties. These are perfect for people who aren't wanting such a large tree type camellia and want something more of a shrub that blooms in the fall, which is nice to have. This one here in particular is Stephanie Golden. It has a beautiful fuchsia pink flower with a yellow throat. The Stephanie Golden only gets about 5 foot high and 4 foot wide at maturity. The other great benefit of some of these dwarf Sasanqua camellias is that they can handle a good bit of sun, about 6 hours with a little bit of afternoon shade, and they'll be a great addition to your landscape for an evergreen flowering shrub. So the last two camellias I want to talk to you about are two most popular by far. The first one is the Shishigashira Camellia Sasanqua. It is a hot pink bloom, very prolific bloomer, and also one of the most popular used by landscapers and homeowners alike. The Shishi Camellia, they're not yet blooming, but as you can see, will be here soon. It only gets about 3 to 5 foot high and 3 to 5 foot wide at maturity. It can easily be maintained at 3 foot. The other one, which is a very similar one, is the Mino Yuki. It is a true white camellia. It is a little bit taller than the Shishi, growing about 6 to 8 foot, but also very shrubby. Both of these can be utilized in a 6 hour sun to a part shade setting. And make a wonderful low maintenance addition to your landscapes. Thank you for joining us today for our first video here at Pinelands Tree Farm. Be sure to like and subscribe to get updates on any new videos we have coming out. And if you're ever in the Florida Panhandle, be sure to visit Pinelands Nursery on Highway 90 and Pinelands Tree Farm here on Fockville Road. Thanks and have a great day.